Welcome to The Art of Living Big. I'm your host, Betsy Pake, and this podcast is designed to share interviews and new ideas to help you redefine what could be possible for your life. Now, let's go live big. Okay. Hello, sweet friends. So, all right, I have so much to share today, and I'm super excited to get into how to manifest magic with you. And I have got some stories, and right now, I'm recording this podcast, first of all, in my car. So, there's more to that story, but just bear with me if it sounds a little funky. I'm doing my best here, and I really wanted to be able to get this message out to you this week for a specific reason, because it'll all make sense at the end. All right. So if you've been a listener of the show, I'm going to guess that you're going to be excited about one of these stories because, well, it's something I talk about a lot. So let's jump right in. What is manifesting? Anyway, so we're going to talk about the 5 steps to manifest magic right now. So what is manifesting? So maybe you've heard that, or maybe you've heard people talk about it, but you're just not really sure what that means. But manifesting is really just the process of making something clear to your eye. So it's really the process of having an idea of something that you want and then bringing it into your life. So how you actually create that in your reality is how you manifest it. So I want to share a quick story about a recent manifestation, and then I'm going to break it down for you. And then I'm going to share with you the motherload of all stories. All right. So you may have heard me talk about on the show about how much my husband loves the University of Georgia sports. So he got his undergrad there. We live close to Athens, Georgia, where the university is. And his favorite time of the year, like by a lot, is football season. And we actually have season tickets. So, I mean, he meets all his friends on Saturdays in the fall, and it is just like this huge celebration. He starts getting really excited a long time before fall is even really here. I mean, he's literally counting down the days, right? So this is a really big deal. He knows all the player details. He knows the backgrounds. He knows all the specifics, and he knows how they've performed while they've been at UGA. He knows, like, their high school records. Like, he's really into it. It's super fun for him. But when football is all done, then what's a boy to do? So he rolls right into basketball, and he loves that too. Although I don't feel like it quite has the same amount of gusto and love behind it, but it is still there, and it's a focus for sure. And we have season tickets to that too. And I don't always go with him to these games, but I do have a ticket. Sometimes he brings a friend, and he knows all about the basketball players too, and he follows along. And so when he asks me to go to a game, I'm usually kind of excited because I know how much it means to him, and if he wants me to go, that seems fun. So when he asked me to go probably about 6 weeks ago, I was pretty excited. Now, I always bring a pen because I know he's going to ask me for one as soon as the game starts, because he likes to keep track of the stats in the program. You know how they give out those programs, and he likes to keep track of everything. Now, this particular game he asked me to go to, they were giving out J.J. Frazier bobblehead dolls. Now, if you're thinking, like, what's a J.J. Frazier bobblehead doll? I was thinking the same thing. J.J. Frazier was a player that graduated last year. So it's just a bobblehead doll made after J.J. Frazier that they were giving away. And if you think that just sounds like some kind of giveaway a kid would like, well, you'd be wrong. This was a really big deal. So my husband was super excited about it. He has like a man cave full of sports and TVs and all of his paraphernalia and all that stuff, right? So it's like basically like a UGA theme he's got going on down there. And so getting the J.J. Frazier bobblehead was really important to him. Like, as silly as that kind of sounds to me, to him, it was really important. And they were giving out only 1,000 of them to the first 1,000 people. Now, when I hear 1,000, that seems like a lot. So I really wasn't in any big yank. I was like, we're always there early. I wasn't worried about it. I knew we'd get there in time. We always are. But this game, we weren't. So we were running late because, well, it's because I needed to get some tacos first, but that's a whole other story, but I gotta eat, right? So we were late, and when we walked in, we weren't handed a bobblehead. and I could see that Craig was getting like a little anxious. So he told me he'd meet me at the seats, and he like went running off to find someone to see if there were any left. I suppose to go to like the other entrances to see if there were any there, but there weren't. And you know, it may sound silly to me, but UGA stuff brings him joy. And if you can't celebrate all the small stuff, then what do you really have, right? So I appreciated it that he was so excited about it. And so I was happy that he ran off to try to find one. But when I got to the seat, he was there and he was looking sort of defeated. I felt so bad because really I knew it was my fault. And he didn't really say anything else. But then right before the game started, I looked at him and he just said, "I'm really sad that we didn't get the bobblehead." Oh my gosh. So, you know, the game, they do the whole warm-up thing and then they do the pledge. And as we rose, we kind of rose up, you know, we stood up for the pledge, and he's on my left-hand side and he turns toward the flag. So I'm looking at his back. You see what I'm saying? So, and I thought someone could just give us one. And I almost said it out loud, like I almost grabbed his shoulder right before the pledge started and said, "Someone might just give us one." But I immediately thought, no, he would never believe that. And I didn't want to hear no. Because, I mean, why would someone just get there early and then give their bobblehead away, right? Like for no reason. I realize that makes no logical sense. So I really just kept it to myself. And I asked myself, do I really think that's possible? And right off, I was like, yes, somebody could totally hand me their bobblehead. And I don't have to know how this is going to happen. I just have to know that it is possible. And I totally felt like that was possible. And then I sort of forgot about it. We watched the game and then we left the stadium. We walked down the street and into a parking garage and headed to the stairs. And as we were walking down the stairs, there was a little boy. He was like maybe 6 or 7. And he had his bobblehead. He was walking down the stairs like right behind me. And he had his bobblehead and he was like kind of clutching it, you know. And I said, and I remember, now my husband is not a big, huge fan of me talking to strangers because I tend to kind of talk to everybody. It's something that I really love. But for whatever reason, I remember thinking I shouldn't say anything because that will annoy Craig, and immediately thinking I feel this overwhelming desire to say something, and so I have to. So just follow me here because this is a little weird. But I had this moment. So this little boy is like holding his bobblehead. And I say to him, "You are so lucky that you got one of the J.J. Frazier bobbleheads." And he hugged it really tight. And his mom laughed. And she said, "Yes, we got here really early just to make sure we got one." And he was really excited. Like I could see his face. And I felt really excited for him. And I said, "That is so awesome." I'm playing it out. This is how it went. And I said, "We tried to get here early, but we didn't make it. And someone," and I kind of nodded to my husband, "is very disappointed." And the mom kind of laughed and chuckled. And I turned back facing forward, right? Because he was behind me. And as I turned forward, a girl in front of me that was a student reached out her arm and handed me her bobblehead. And she said, "You can have mine." And then the girl right next to her said, "Oh, you can have mine too. We're students and we got them automatically and we didn't really want them." Not one JJ bobblehead, but two JJ Frazier bobbleheads. That, my friends, is the power of belief, following your instincts, and releasing all resistance. So I'm going to break this down and then I'm going to share an even better story that I think you're going to love, that I hope you love. So Abraham Hicks talks about the steps to move forward in manifesting what you really want in your life. And so I'm going to go through those manifestation steps and I'm going to explain them in my own experience. So maybe I can make it a little bit clearer for you and kind of share my spin on them, because I feel like I am a master manifester, a super attractor, as I like to say. So I want to share that with you because I want you to be that too. All right. So here's how it goes. All day long, you're feeling preferences, right? So all day long, you're going, "I really like that. I don't like that. That seems good. That doesn't seem good. This coffee isn't hot enough. I like hot coffee that's hotter. I wish there wasn't so much traffic. I wish I got a better parking spot. Ooh, I'm happy I got this parking spot. I like that there's people that are parked far away from me so my car won't get dinged. Do you see what I'm saying? So you're doing that all day long without even really paying attention. So you're constantly having preferences and you're sharing those preferences like with yourself. You're thinking those preferences, but you're sharing them with the universe. Now, step one is ask for what you want. And that is just your contrast all day long. So as you're having contrast and you're asking for what you want and you're noticing that you like this or you don't like this and you're getting clarity, the universe is listening to you and it's listening to your preferences. So you don't have to effort on step one at all. It just kind of happens just like that. Okay. Step two, this one is going to get, this is where it's already getting tricky with how you're going to be thinking, but I want you to just open up your mind because as we work through all the steps, it'll kind of come together. Okay. So step one is just ask, right? Ask, have your preferences, feel your contrast and ask for what you want. Step two, it is given. So in the universe, it's already done. The JJ bobblehead was already mine because I asked for it. And so the universe immediately begins working on bringing it to you. It begins lining up all of the situations. There are probably limitless, truly unlimited ways I could have gotten a JJ bobblehead that night. But one of the ways was by talking out loud to the little boy behind me so that a student that didn't want theirs could hear me. So as soon as you ask, as soon as you have step one, step two is that the universe, it's already done. It hears you. It's already there. And this part can seem really odd, especially because we don't see it happening and it doesn't happen instantly. It's not like I have a preference. I wish this coffee was hotter and all of a sudden the coffee's boiling. Like it's not happening immediately. But it's happening. So how does your manifestation really start once you have contrast, once you complete step one? So have you ever heard that saying, believe it and you will see it? Yeah, that. So we're going to get into a little bit more of that. But the point here is that when you have a preference, you have a vibration that's associated with that preference. The vibration is what is happening. Okay, if you're new here and you've never heard of vibration, let me explain it really quickly. Everything is a vibration. Everything is energy. Even your thoughts have a vibration. Your car has a vibration. Your table has a vibration. The earth is a vibration, right? Everything's got a vibration, right? Energetically. So when you have a thought, good or bad, whatever it is a vibration. Okay, so back to step two. It's already done. And I believe many times we get hung up here because of fear. Unconsciously, I think fear makes us feel kind of good. I think maybe there's a biological reason for that. But it keeps us, first of all, from being super disappointed. And I believe we kind of have a fear of feeling good because if we feel too good, we might not be on guard and something bad could happen. And then, you know, we get all screwy thinking from that. So believing that something amazing can happen or releasing the idea that it won't is where most people get hung up in this process. So step one is ask. Step two, it is already there. Now on to step three. Step three is allow. So if you've asked for it and it's already there, how do you actually get to it? So this is really just more of step two where the universe is the vibration, but this is about getting better on keeping your alignment about the thing. So this is about getting really good about your alignment. You ask for the JJ bobblehead, Fraser bobblehead. You understand that absolutely that could happen. I totally believe that can happen. In fact, in the universe, it already has happened. Now I just have to release the resistance that it won't happen and get on the vibration that it could. And in that instance, in that example, I totally believed that is totally possible. And I did not get hung up at all about how. So in this step, Now, and if you think about it this way, like step one and two is like almost like you have a limited control, right? Because you're just having preferences and contrast all day long. Step two, the universe is just dishing stuff up. You discover contrast in your day, then the universe matches it. So that part's done. So step three, the part we're on, the step that we're on is really fun because it's really where you get a chance to create what you want. Where you get a chance to create what you want. I want to say that again because I wanted you to hear me. So in this step, you need to get in the vibrational vicinity of the thing that you do want so that it can be realized by you. When you become that vibrational match, this is when you really start to see the thing that has already been brought into existence in step two. So this is also the step where I think it's really helpful to take spiritually aligned action. So you'll hear me say that lots of times. I get in alignment and then I do my work. So this is why. I need to be able to follow the nudges from the universe. And it's harder for me to hear them if, like, I'm all stuck in a wad or I'm all hung up on something that I don't want. So when I have preferences all day long, just like you, and the universe is working for those. So I decide what it is I really want. So get a clear vision. What is it I really want? And then I get in that feeling. I get in that feeling. And then I start to do the things that seem like the right things to do. So how I do this is I get in a really good mood every morning. I do different things to get in a good mood. And then I pay attention. I have a list of things I need to do. I pay attention to what feels good to do. Now, I work for myself. So I realize I have a benefit there. But I also have a lot of other things working against me that you might not. So I make a list. And if you work for somebody else, you may have a list of tasks you have to do, but the order in which you do those may be up to you, or how you do those, or maybe where you do those is up to you. So I try to get in a really good feeling place, and then I pay attention to what feels like the right thing to do on my list first. So if I'm in a really good spot and I feel really good, I do the action that feels really good. And I know that that's moving me towards what it is I really want in my life, like my destiny. All right, so step four, and step two, step three, step four, you'll find they're all very similar. All we're doing is hyper-adjusting. All we're doing is really tuning in. So step four is to find the thing that feels really good in every subject. So this is really just step three, but doing it really consistent. So this is where you're appreciating your life, like just as your default setting. It doesn't mean that you never experience any kind of contrast or any kind of negative feeling. It just means that you're aware of it and that it's a whole lot simpler for you to choose the positive sides of most topics. So I believe one of the keys is to focus on the other side of the coin. So every single problem has two sides, right? The side you don't like, which is like your contrast, and then the opposite, or the side that you do like. So if you spend your time focusing on what you don't like, that's where your point of attraction is. And that's the point of attraction is really what you're manifesting. Does that make sense? So if you spend your time focusing on what you don't like, what you don't like becomes your point of attraction, and your point of attraction is what you're manifesting more of. So your point of attraction at any time is simply your focus. So what are you focused on right now? That's your point of attraction. So step one is simply getting the contrast and therefore clarity on things that you'd like to do or be or have in your experience, right? And then this step four, I believe is about looking at the other side of it. Now, I'm going to give you an example of this. So my husband like empties the dishwasher like hardly ever. Okay. But when he does, he puts things away anywhere that it's handy, like not necessarily where they go. All right. You feel me here? So remember what my focus is my point of attraction. And my point of attraction is what I'm bringing more of into my life. So I think to myself every time I see something in the wrong spot, instead of thinking, oh my God, can he not put anything away? He never even does the dishwasher, because I don't want more of that. So instead I think, ooh, this is so nice. This means I'm not the only one putting stuff away in the kitchen. That's a great feeling. I appreciate that he did this because these are little pieces of evidence that he's been helping me, right? So I'm not saying potential like relationship issues should be ignored or you shouldn't set boundaries. I'm not saying that. I'm just using that as an example of shifting your focus. Although you could try this method of constantly focusing on what you do like, and I'm 1,000% that your feelings will start to shift and your relationship could change. But all I'm trying to do is just clarify that this is a clarifying to step one, getting clear on you want and what you want. Dr. Wayne Dyer, he said, feeling good is feeling God. And I really like that. And so all this is when you have contrast, focus on the feeling good part. What part feels good to you? Now, step five is the last step of manifestation. And this is where you're welcoming the contrast. So you're not beating yourself up if things get out of alignment. So if you start to feel bad, you don't go, oh my God, I've screwed up. I'm out of alignment. This isn't right. You just understand the value of something bad happening. And you see how that's actually helping you on your path. So if you're taking action and you run into an obstacle, remember that it's actually not an obstacle. It's actually just there to redirect you on how to get to the thing that you're vibrating at. So if you're vibrating at the vibration of what it is you want and you run into a snag, it's not a snag. It's part of the path. So have fun with this. The faster the manifestation is going to be, the faster or the more fun you're having. So if you're having a lot of fun with this, like I had the idea about the JJ bobblehead. Somebody could hand that to me. Absolutely. And then I had a lot of fun and I watched the game. And they talked about the JJ Frazier bobblehead. Hold up your bobbleheads, right? Like, and I just felt like fun. Like, this is fun. I can't wait. Someone's going to hand this to us later. I can't wait to see how that's going to happen. Not concerned about it. And if I started to feel like, oh, like that angst, like, oh no, I feel bad. Craig didn't get it. I immediately shifted and thought like, but think about how excited he'll feel when he does get it. And he was pretty freaking excited. So it was really cool. So remember, this is step five. Everything is unfolding in perfect timing. So here are the main tips. Just go about your day and see what you like and what you don't like. And you know that whatever you want is already happening because you want to see it. You try to get on the vibration of that thing. The key is, don't focus on what is. This can be so hard. So don't focus on what you're seeing. Practice the feeling of what you want and focus on that. Distract yourself from what is. I couldn't focus on how I didn't have the JJ Frazier bobblehead. We focused on how someone was going to give it to us and all these people had it and how fun that was. We live in a universe that's vibrationally based. We don't tend to deal with the universe from a vibrational standpoint. We do it from an action standpoint, from a hustle, hustle, hustle. But if you can start to shift your thinking so that you're thinking vibrationally, it will become clearer and easier for you to manifest what you want. All right. I have a last story for you. You've heard me on the show, and so you know my love of the beach. Sometimes I get really stuck not liking where I am. But there are two sides. So instead, I try to turn my attention constantly to what I do like about being at the beach. So when I have contrast, this is how it goes. I hate where I live, which I don't totally hate it, but this is what happens to me. I hate where I live. I start to focus on what I don't like. And so I immediately start to shift. I immediately say, oh, but you know what I do love? I love the way it feels when I'm at the ocean. I love having the wind in my hair and how my hair feels all beachy when I leave the beach. And I love how it smells. And I love, my hair gets all this texture from the salt water and the sun gets on my face and I can hear the ocean. Like, I just go on and on. Literally, when I have the feeling about how I don't like where I live, I immediately shift to that. It's hard. Sometimes it can be really hard, but I try to shift And I also will try to find stuff that I do like about where I am. And that sometimes can be fun too. So do you see the shift there? So instead of how I hate where I am, I focus on what I like about where I want to be. Because step two, it's already there. It's already there. Now, I cannot live at the... I'm catching myself. I'm choosing right now not to move to the beach for various reasons. One is because I have a daughter who's in high school and I want her to stay in high school through her high school years, and I want her to live near her dad. And there's a lot of reasons. So I'm making the choice to not live at the beach right now, but I still have the yank to live at the beach. And so I want to be around the beach. I want to be at the beach. I want to visit the beach. I want to have beachy stuff around. So there are times where even though I'm consciously making this choice to be where I am, I know that step two is already happened. I know that the universe has a beautiful beach home waiting for me in my vortex. I just can't see it yet because right now I'm focused on doing other things, right? So that's where the shift is. So then I'm just in a better place, and I'm in a better place because I'm happy thinking about the beach. I'm in a better place appreciating what's good about where I am. So think about that. Think about something that you don't like, and then imagine the difference and see how much better it feels when you get to the side of the coin that feels good. So remember, the whole key is that I just want to feel good. That's when you're on the right path. I don't want to feel bad. I want to feel good. So a few weeks ago, I decided that I wanted to go to the beach for spring break. And it was odd because we have some other trips planned. So right now, it wasn't in our value system for me to go to the beach. Now, if you listen to my episode on money, you will know why I said it the way I just said it. It wasn't in my value system to go to the beach, but I really wanted to go. And so I was saying to my friends how I wanted to go on a trip, and I thought, I want to go just with Olive. Florida would be a fun place to get away. It would be fun to go for spring break. You know, Olive's had a hard year, but now she's doing really well, and it would be good to get away and kind of celebrate that. Now, my dad lives in Florida, and visiting him wasn't an option. And so at first, I got really annoyed by that. And so I shifted that. So there was this moment where I felt constriction. I would have a place to go, but I can't go because of this, right? So I got annoyed, but I released it. And then I thought, well, I guess that means there must be something better coming for me in Florida. So I kept focusing on how we were going on spring break and what that would feel like. Now, remember, I've been bringing the beach into my vortex in all different ways, thinking about it, and mostly thinking about this beach house that really cannot manifest until after Olive graduates, right? So when I started about 2 weeks ago really thinking I want to go on the beach, I probably already had a lot of beach in my vortex because I've been thinking about it. So last week, I decided I'd just calculate how much gas I'd need to get to Florida on spring break. So I have a Prius. It was like nothing. Literally, it was a tank of gas. It was like $19. And so I sort of celebrated that. I talked to Olive and I told her how inexpensive it would be to drive to the beach. But then I remember after that, I kind of let it go. And then I felt like it was seeming easier and easier to get to the beach. Although that how, you know, like the how am I going to get the J.J. Frazier? I don't know. I just know it's coming. I just know someone's going to hand it to me. That's how I felt about the beach. So remember, it wasn't in my value system to rent a place at the beach. But I remember when I said what it would cost, I felt satisfied. Like I didn't feel like I needed to do anything about that. And I went and got my nails done, and the lady was going to the beach for the spring break, and I was talking to her, and I said, I really would like to go to the beach for spring break. She said, why don't you go? And I said, well, my dad doesn't have room at his place, so I'm not sure where we would go. And she said, just rent a place. And I said, well, I don't think I'll need to. And I remember I said that, and I remember that felt very real. I don't think I'll need to. But I still had this really weird story. Wonderful feeling that I was going to be going to the beach. So, like I do with the aligned action, I just felt one day like it was time to clean out all my bathing suits. You know, if you're like me, like I end up having a million bathing suits. And so I got them all out and I figured out what I would pack if I were to go to the beach, like what was good, like what was still in the season, what wasn't all I mean, I tend to wear stuff for so long that, like, what's too old? I'm throwing stuff out. And I just started cleaning out. So keep in mind, I had no plan to get to the beach. I didn't know how. But just like with the J.J. Frazier bobblehead, I didn't really need to know how. So I really released that thought altogether. And I just moved forward with my plans just because it felt good. So it felt good to clean out and to pick my bathing suits and to decide what I was going to bring and decide what how I would drive there and what it would cost me in gas. All that just felt good. So I was just working on allowing it to come with me, and I was having fun figuring it all out. So remember, aligned action, all this felt good to me for a reason. And it's because I was in the vicinity and I was on the vibration of the beach. So I may have talked about this on the show before, but I have a block on my browser on my computer, so I'm only allowed to spend 10 minutes a day on Facebook. So after 10 minutes, like, it literally shuts me down. I can't log in. So I found I was just wasting a lot of time, and I wasn't in alignment, and I was just mindlessly looking at Facebook. And so I decided to just get off. And I actually heard that in a meditation, by the way, but saying happy birthday to people on Facebook in the mornings brings me joy. And so I decided I would have a 10-minute timer so that I could set the timer, say happy birthday to everybody, and then have time to log off. So that's what I did. So remember, last week I was going to log in. So I was in alignment. I was feeling good. I was doing all these beachy things, right? And I went to go log in, and something said, don't do it yet, which was really odd because I like to do, like, typically I like to do the Facebook messages in the morning. It's sort of like I want everybody to get my message in the morning, sort of like I just want to be the first one to say happy birthday to people. And so it was weird that I didn't want to do it, but I really felt like, no, not yet. And so I remember I just logged out, and I thought, well, I guess I'll just do it later. And so later in the day, I thought, I'm going to get on and say happy birthday now. I felt like doing it. And so it's odd because usually when I pop on, I don't see my feed. So I made it so that there are some groups I follow and some other stuff that pops up first, because that way I don't get sucked in. But on this day, I logged in, and the first post that popped up, well, I'm going to get to this in just a second. I want to point out an issue with aligned action. And if you try this, you may experience it. To be in aligned action, aligned to the thing you want, you have to have the belief that the thing is there. The problem is that you may have a belief system running in your subconscious about what you're capable of, what you think you're worthy of, and what you think really could happen for you or for anyone else. So let me ask you this, honestly, do you think that I could really get a free week at the beach during spring break, which is like one of the busiest beach times of the year? Like, I bet not, if you're being honest. If I talked to you last week and told you all of the things I was doing and thinking, you probably would have poo-pooed it. Not to be a jerk, but just because you, that just probably wouldn't have been in your belief system. And honestly, even maybe a year ago, it wouldn't have been in mine. And even now, it felt a tiny bit far-fetched, but not really. More than anything, I felt like anything was possible in the same way that anything was possible with the bobblehead. So what happens when we have this belief system is that it shuts us off. So we think it's not possible, and so then we don't see the signs around us that show us how it could be possible. So what if free trips to the beach were all around me, but I was in such belief that I didn't even see it, and I couldn't see it even if I tried? Does that feel far-fetched to you? Well, that afternoon when I finally felt aligned to jump on Facebook, I saw a friend's post. She's a super cool chick, and I've always really loved her. She's not afraid to speak her mind. Her posts are always funny, and I just have a lot of respect for her. She worked for me as a coach when I owned my CrossFit gym, but honestly, she was way more than a coach. Like, she helped me with so much stuff, and she's a financial whiz. And so when I saw her post, I decided to read it, and the picture looked like her kitchen floor was being torn up. Now, the post said, my house has flooded and we can't use the fully paid condo at Daytona Beach. If anyone wants it, you're welcome to it. Free. Oh my God, me. I said right off, I'm totally open to receiving, right? More on that, because I struggle with that sometimes, but I was like, oh my God, this is it. And so I texted her And I did this with all sincerity. And I asked her, could I meet with the workmen that were going to fix her kitchen? Because honestly, I would be more than happy to do that. But she said no, that they were going to stay and that there was someone in front of me for the trip. So she, you know, she just said, there's somebody else that wants it. But if something happens and they can't go or they change their mind, I'll let you know. So now, honestly, if you heard that, what would you do? Someone else had claimed the room first. So she would just let me know if they changed their mind. What would you do? Would you wait to hear? Would you think, why would anyone change their mind? I decided to pack. I called my husband, who had court this week and sadly couldn't come with us, but I told him Olive and I were going. Now, remember, I wanted a specific girls' trip. Remember? That was one of the things I had clarity on. I really wanted Olive and I to be able to get to spend some time together. I had already organized all my swimsuits 2 days before, so I pulled all the things I had already decided I would bring, and I put them in my suitcase. My dog got all panty, all nervous I was going to leave, but we were going to have to leave in the morning, so I wanted to get going. Now, remember, someone else has already got the room, but I knew that I did not come this far and see that post in the way that I did to have it not be me. And so I texted Olive's best friend's mom to see if she could come with us. And I planned. Remember, someone else had the room, but I knew they didn't. So about 30 minutes later, I got a text. It's yours if you want it, but let me know because someone else is behind you. So I had to have a conversation with Craig face to face about plans. And then I told her yes. And we left about 15 hours later, free trip to the beach. 7 days, oceanfront. I'm here now. This is all happening right now. And I will tell you that it is amazing. I'm insanely enthusiastic about being here. I'm soaking it all in. I'm watching the waves every day for hours. I'm getting up early every single day to see the sunrise. I'm saying thank you to the beautiful moon every night. I've put tears in the ocean and I've happily stomped my feet in the sand. I've said hello to everyone I meet and I've been quiet and creative when inspiration hit. I shared some new ideas with people and I stopped and read new books that felt just right. I've seen every sunrise, and I've stood in awe at every color that the sky shared through the sunset. I meditated by the ocean, and I listened for the wise words of my intuition. I grounded on the ocean floor, and I praised the universe for sharing this amazing earth with me. I didn't hide who I am. That is so much trouble. And I watched my daughter become more comfortable with herself, too. I have lived all the life out of this week, and I am so full. Happy, thank you. More, please. And now I'm just trying to figure out, what do I want next? In fact, last night I manifested a free dessert for the girls at the restaurant, but that's a whole other story for another day. But let me ask you, what do you want to manifest? Let me know. Come find me on Instagram. See all my pictures from the beach and tell me what you want, because I really want to know and maybe I can help. You know where to find me. And remember, all of this is available for you. In fact, it's already manifested. You just have to get in the vibration of it so that you can see it manifest right before your eyes. I believe we deserve it. I believe we came here to have all these experiences in life, the ups, the downs, all the emotions, the dreams, and all the beach trips that you might have in mind. You deserve it, and you deserve to live a big life. Thanks so much for listening. Remember, you can find me all over social media at Betsy Pake. And as always, here's a little message from my husband.
Woo! That's it!